New Vision Christian Center.
Second service, praying.
Yes, yes.
Oh Lord, I pray that the musicians get their blessing, oh Lord. Oh Lord, the people about it singing if there wasn't already.
Watching over our live streaming ways, amen. We welcome you to New Vision Christian Center, Church of God in Christ, where our pastor is the superintendent, William R. Ephraim, and our district missionary is District Missionary Kenita Smith, amen. Come on, let's take it. Let's get ready. My God. Hallelujah. 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 Jesus. I plead the blood of Jesus in this atmosphere. I plead the blood of Jesus over our friends, over our family. I plead the blood of Jesus over this service. Hallelujah. Satan is defeated and God is exalted and we're going to have the victory. Amen. Hallelujah. Come on, let's ride. Ah, yes. The old saints used to tell us, together. church, in the prayer room. Yeah.
Church.
Sometimes we gotta make the declaration that the King shall forever be exalted. No one else will get the glory. No one else will get the honor. No one else will get the credit, because my God did it. And I'm gonna forever exalt the name of Jesus. How do you know that the King shall forever be exalted? King shall forever be lifted up. Hallelujah.
Oh, stand to your feet and come down to the altar. Hallelujah. Amen. Our minister, Michelle Ephraim, she's coming at this time to do an altar call. I would do it, but I don't have no, I ain't got no voice left. I gave God my all, and it's a little on the minimal side. But if she can, or Minister Washington, amen, listen, come on. We got a room full of ministers. Somebody gonna come up here and do it. Hallelujah, all right? It don't matter who do it. It just matters that you just get ready to pray. Hallelujah.
Meet their needs right now, Lord God. Father, you know of them, Father. Even the deep things, Father, the things that they can't even share with anyone else, Lord God. The things in the midnight hour, Father, in the 3 o'clock hour, Father, the 6 o'clock hour, Father. Father, you know all about those things, Lord God. Father, we love you, Father. We honor you, Lord God, on today, Lord God. Father, you are God, Father, who can fulfill all our needs, Father. Fulfill all the things that is hurting inside of us, Lord God. Father, I ask that you go to the hospital right now, Lord God, and touch those who are in infirmity, Father. Father, those are broken down with sickness, Father, in their body, Lord God. Father, I prophesy unto them that they will live and not die, Father, and proclaim the works of the Lord unto them, Lord God. They shall live and not die and proclaim the works of the Lord, Father. But those who are standing in need of healing right now, Lord God, healing is being ministered over the room right now, Lord God. Father, who need breakthrough in their marriage right now, Lord God. Who need a breakthrough with their relationship with their kids right now, Lord God. Father, I ask that you minister unto them right now, Lord God. Whatever their needs are, Father, it is in this place, Lord God, that it can be met right now, Lord God. I ask that you stir up the waters now, right now, Lord God. Stir up the waters right now, Father. Let them step in, Father, in faith, Lord God. Father, you said if this mountain be removed, Father, what is hindering them, Father? They ask that it be moved out of their way right now, Lord God. Father, be in faith, Father. Let them be in good cheer, Lord God. Let them know that all things are possible, Father, through you, Lord God. The creator of heaven and hell, heaven and earth, Lord God. What is impossible with you, Lord God? What is impossible with you, Father? Nothing, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, for pouring your spirit in this place, Lord God. Touch the man of God who's going to deliver the word on today, Lord God. Touch him, Father, Father, from the crown of his head to the bottom of his feet, Lord God. Let him stand in boldness, Father. Let him stand in your integrity, Father, the word, Lord God. Let his angel encamp around him, Father. Keep him, Father. Touch our pastor right now, Lord God. Minister unto this leader of this house, Lord God. Because he need a prayer too, Lord God. And keep him lifted up, Father. All of us should be lifting up the man of God. All the people on the minister's staff, Lord God. All the deacon and the deaconess, Lord God. All those in their prospective places, Lord God. I ask that you continue to lift them up, Father. Father, we thank you, Lord God. We consider these things done, Father. We know it is done, Lord God. And we wave, Father. We thank you, Father. We waver not, Lord God. For these things are done in your Son Jesus' mighty name. In the mighty name of Jesus, it is done and it is so. Amen.
Do a little something, though. Isn't she doing a good job? Can we put our hands together for her? I am up here to do your words of empowerment, amen. Amen. I do believe that our ministerial staff is entering at this time. If we could all rest on our feet, amen, in reverence and respect of our leader, none other than the pastor of this great church, the superintendent of the Midwestern District, and the overseer of New Hope Foundation Ministries and the prophet to the nations, Superintendent William R. Eagle. Come on, make some noise for our pastor. I said make some noise for our pastor. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. You may be seated. Amen. The other Sunday, it was a few Sundays ago, I was getting ready to get up here, and I was going to do words of empowerment, amen, but the Spirit came in and took over, and I was getting ready to tell the story, and so I told Sister Maria Johnson, I told her, I said, well, I'm going to have to save that story for another day, amen, but I'm going to tell that story today in connections with your words of empowerment. So there was this young man. His name was Jimmy, and Jimmy was in high school, and he had a love for running track and field. Jimmy loved track and field. He loved the idea. He just loved it all, and he would sit and watch the Olympics, and he would watch 1997, 1998, 1999. He would just sit there and watch the Olympics, and whenever his mother would walk in the door, she said, well, what you watching? He'd look at her and say, Mom, you know what I'm watching. And he would fast forward past all of the games and stuff that they would do, all of the sports and stuff, and he'd go straight to track and field. Except Jimmy was diagnosed severely with cerebral palsy. But he loved the act of watching track and field. And so he was in high school, and every time that it came time for the tryouts for the track and field team, he would go and try out. And year after year, he wouldn't make the team. And he'd go back again, and he'd try out again, and he wouldn't make the team. And he'd go back again, and he'd try out again, and he wouldn't make the team. Except this year, the coach had an extra uniform. And when he went and he tried out, and the coach seen he had an extra uniform, the coach said, you know what? He's been consistent. We just gonna give it to him. Just give it to him. And so Jimmy asked his coach, he said, when you gonna let me run, coach? Coach was like, well, I'ma think about it. And every practice he'd come, Jimmy say, when you gonna let me run, coach? Coach said, I'll think about it. Jimmy came again, when you gonna let me run, coach? Coach said, you know what? I'ma let you run the 800 at the track meet, the championship track meet. And so it came time on that special day, and they got to the starting line, and the coach, as Jimmy was getting to the line, the coach said, you know what? Because of his condition, we know that he's not going to place. But what we're going to do, we're going to gather together, and we're going to get him a trophy. And so him, the coach, and the teammates got together, and they got Jimmy a trophy. And the coach said, the only way that Jimmy can get that trophy is if he finishes the race. Look at your neighbor, say, finish the race. And so it came time for Jimmy. Jimmy was at the starting line, and the starting pistol went off. Everybody started running. They were gone, and here goes little Jimmy, running as fast as he can. And he was running, and he seen that the other racers started getting further and further in front of him. And so he started to talk out loud to his teammates that he was running by on the sideline, and he said, I might as well quit, because they're so far ahead of me. And his teammates just kept telling him, finish the race. And so he thought to himself, he got a little further, and he passed by the opposing team. And he was like, I might as well quit. And the opposing team told him, finish the race. Finish the race. You've got to finish the race. Next thing you know, he got ready to get lapped up. The rest of the racers got ready to pass him up. And when they passed him up, Jimmy thought to himself, he said, you know what? I may not be as fast as them, but I'm going to be consistent. I'm going to let my faith and my trust in God drive me. Next thing you know, Jimmy began to get a little speed in his stride. He began to run a little faster. he began to run a little faster. He began to run a little faster, and he kept running, and he kept running. Next thing you know, he caught up to the other teammates. And the other teammates that were running, they slowed down, and they asked Jimmy, they said, Jimmy, what do you think that you are doing? And Jimmy said, I've got to finish this race. I've got to finish this race that I have been called to run. I've got to finish this race that I've been called to preach. I've got to finish this race that I've been called to sing. I've got to finish this race that I've been called to serve.
Come on, son.
Yes, yes, yes.
And so the other racers, when they passed the finish line, they got to the edge and they began to cheer Jimmy on. They said, Jimmy, finish the race. Jimmy, finish the race. Jimmy, finish the race. Shamika, finish the race. Minister Campbell, finish the race. Zoe, finish the race. Finish the race. Sister Elvis, finish the race. Sister Isaac, finish the race. Sister Ivory, finish the race. Mama Michelle, Minister Ephraim, finish the race. They began to cheer him on as he was making his way across the finish line. And when he got across the finish line, Jimmy yelled with a loud voice. He said, I finished the race. I just came by and I stopped by here to encourage you, let you know you got to finish this race that you're running. You got to finish the race. And what my superintendent, my pastor, always tell me, he said, you got to connect it to Scripture. You can't just be up here exhorting and you ain't connected to Scripture. For the Bible gives us this intelligence in Hebrews 12, 1 and 2. Wherefore, seeing we are also compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doeth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. So I just came by here to encourage you and to let you know, as long as you keep your eyes to the hills from which cometh your help, and you trust and believe that all your help comes from the Lord, how many of you know you can finish the race? I came to finish the race. I'm going to do whatever it takes to finish the race. Whatever it takes to complete the battle. The battle's already won. Victory is already in our hands because you've been trusting and believing in God. And I tell you, it's something about trusting and believing that God can and that God will and that you will be able to finish the race. And you know what the coach said to little old Jimmy when he went over there and got his trophy from his teammates? His coach said, well done, Jimmy. Well done, Jimmy. Well done, Jimmy. So I just came to let you know, if you just keep running this race with patience, if you just keep running this race with endurance, if you just keep running this race, I promise you, our God, our Father in heaven, when you walk through those pearly gates, and when you kneel before his throne, I promise you, if you live the life right, he's going to tell you, well done. I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God, which is in Christ Jesus. I'm going to be like the woman with the issue of blood. I'm going to press my way. I'm going to be like Zacchaeus when he wanted to see Jesus. I'm going to press my way. I'm going to be like Peter when he was walking on the water. I'm going to press my way. I'm going to press my way. Press your way, division. Press your way. And finish the race.
I'm a finish the race. It seems he feel like preaching. We just came out of a revival in Texas, and Elder Minister Asante and Sister Gator and Sister Whitney and Brother Sister Terry Turner from Greater St. John's and our children, they were with us. We had a great time. We still in revival mode. Amen. I still feel like shouting. Amen. I still feel like running around the building. Even though I know I can't run. Amen. I had my little girl to run around for me in Amarillo. Amen. Promise. I mentioned Ron, she got up and lit out, boy. So folks, get out of her way, she's gonna run. Amen. God's good, isn't he? I'm sort of subdued today, but I certainly am happy to be with you all on this fourth Sunday. There's so much going on and so much sadness. Amen. We actually have three of our members of our jurisdiction that we got to bury, and all of them are young. Amen. One of them is 28. We just did one that was 19. And then two others, one is Missionary Wills' daughter, works in our office in the jurisdiction. Amen. It's just, and then I had someone I was going to baptize today, but they have COVID. Look at somebody and say they got COVID. The Lord gave me how to baptize people with COVID. And I've been getting calls saying thank you, showing them how to do it during this time. But that's not why I got up. I got up because I want to say thank you all for your support. And happy for to be in the land of the living. Amen. Amen. I'm glad that God has spared my life. And I'm happy to see all of you all alive. Look at somebody and say, you don't have to be alive now. You could be dead. Years ago when I get up, I used to say, take a deep breath. I'm hearing a roaring, something's going on. And when they take the deep breath, I said, you like doing that? They said, yeah. I said, I do too. Because that means you're alive. God is good. We're certainly living in perilous times. But it's amazing that he was talking about running a race, because we got a young lady here with us today that's in a race. Amen. And many don't realize how important these things are. But there was a time when we would never have a black woman, or man for that matter, in a race in the county of El Paso. Amen. Which is one of those unique counties in the state of Colorado. But I believe we have one here today. I'm looking at her. And she's here to say a couple of words to us, whatever the Lord lays in her heart. And she's invited to come. She's not forcing her way. We want her to come. Sister Regina English, I believe. Yes. Amen. She's going to come at this time to speak to us concerning her quest. Amen. Somebody say amen.
Thank you for allowing me to share with you today. I honestly really didn't come to speak. I have been on the phone with Deacon Scott about helping support the 50th anniversary for Superintendent.
Yeah.
And so he shared that Youth Sunday was today. And I said, okay, I'll be there. Because I'm very, very dedicated. And it's my obligation to make sure that all our students are being set up for success. So for those of you who don't know me, like Superintendent said, my name is Regina English. I currently lead on the Board of Education for Harrison School District 2. Thank you, thank you. Sit on many boards and committees across the state of Colorado. So I understand the dynamics of community and what's needed. And I also believe that representation matters. And it's very important that we have people in these seats making decisions for us that look like us.
Yes.
It's very important to have every single perspective at the table in order to make an informed decision. Now, I've been running this race for a long time, and I ain't tired yet. I'm not up here to testify, right? Because I had a primary election. I did. It was a tough race. But I said, those who he called, he fully equips. Those who he calls, he fully equips. So I know he already made provisions for me, right? So here's the testimony. I didn't have all those big dollars, right? Because all money ain't good money. But I know my daddy got a lot of money. I didn't have all those organizational endorsements, but I was endorsed by my father and mother because I know who I am and whose I am, right? So I do stand before you today as the Democratic candidate for House District 17 when they said I wouldn't be. When they said I wouldn't be, y'all. And this is a specific assignment that only Regina English can do. I understand the call on my life. This race is bigger than me. It goes beyond the seat. But God is positioning his people that believe in him, his children, to be in these seats making decisions according to what his word says. So those of us that will say yes to the call and be bold enough to stand and give the pushback where we need to, those are the ones he's going to place in the seat. And I am honored to be a child of God. For us, especially as black people, to show up and vote. Very important. Because if our vote didn't matter, they wouldn't be trying to take it away from us. And if our vote didn't matter, President Biden wouldn't be in a seat right now. If our vote didn't matter. So the black vote definitely carries weight. The black vote definitely carries weight. So I encourage you, sis, I encourage you, my brother, when you get your ballots October the 17th, make sure you fill out your ballots. Turn them in. Don't wait till November the 8th. What if God said he gonna wait to do something for us? Right? We procrastinate, but I bind that spirit of procrastination right now in the name of Jesus. I take authority over that spirit right now in the name of Jesus. We must do our part, be a part of the legislative process. It is very important. If you don't understand, give me a call. We can talk about it because education is key. And also, I will just plug for Representative Tony Exum, who is currently in the seat for House District 17. He is term limited, so he has endorsed me for his seat. And he's running for Senate District 11. So we're not here to solicit votes. I'm not. But I am here to say it's important for us to be a part of the legislative process. It's very important for us to show up and vote. But you know what? I trust and believe God that there will be victory November 8th. There will be victory November the 8th. Because I know that God has his hand on my life. God has his hands all in this race because everything is coming into alignment. I am definitely in alignment with the assignment. We have to be in alignment with the assignment and understand the call that God has on our life. There's been several people, before I wrap up, there's been several people that came to me and said, if you don't take God out of this race, you lose my vote. I said, sorry to lose your vote. I said, sorry to lose your vote. Because again, like I said, I know whose I am and whose I am. So I thank you, Superintendent, for allowing me to get up and speak today. But this is not even about me, it's about these babies. And I just want to let y'all know that I love you all. Everything I do for you all. There is nothing that you can't do that you put your mind to. Yeah. I stand before you successful, very, very strong and mighty in the word of God. I'm a praying woman, and I am here to make the best decisions for you all, to make sure that you all get a high quality education that you all deserve. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. And I just want to let the babies know and the parents know. I also sit on the RISE Coalition. It's called Resilient, Inspire, Strong, Engage. I'm on a board of directors, right? I am RISE. I am Resilient, Inspire, Strong, and Engage. And we just had our grand opening back August 20th for the Panorama Park. So if you all have not visited the Panorama Park, you should take your kids and visit this park because it is definitely a destination place for the city of Colorado Springs, and that park has been packed ever since we opened it. It's a safe space. We had a group of young people called the Yak Youth Advisory Council, and they designed this park, and they said what it was that they wanted. So it's just creating a safe space for you all to go. So I encourage you to share with your moms and dads to take you all to Panorama Park. And that's just one project of many, y'all, right? It's just one of many. I know God has positioned me for such a time as this to make sure that our community get the investment that we deserve. So thank you. The location is on Fenton Drive. The Panorama Park is right behind Panorama Middle School. So y'all should go. Y'all should go. It's really a nice place, and it has a bathroom, y'all, and it's clean. These are things that really don't happen. So this is an $8.9 million park, the largest park renovation in the history of the city of Colorado Springs, and I'm honored to have been a part of that planning process along with other community partners and people in the city of Colorado Springs. Trust for public land. So I'm not just up here looking cute, y'all. It's not about that. It's not about that. It's about the work and the call that God has on my life to be that voice for us and amplify the voice of not only black people, but all people, because we all deserve a better quality of life. Thank you.
And far as I know, up to this point, she's the only person that's in the political realm that has helped us with this 50th anniversary thing. I'm doing everything I can to stay out of it because it's supposed to be for me. Give her another hand, please. I feel like I ought to be doing something, but I know I shouldn't. Amen. Sometimes I get up and I just want to take over.
Take over, sir.
But then I looked at these beautiful children and I said to myself, wow. And I want to give you into the hand. Who is the facilitator of this? Well, there she is, Miss Zoe Scott. Say amen for her as she comes.
Instead of New Vision, instead of Sunshine Band, I'm so sorry, kid. We're gonna have Brother Malachi Harris come for a praise dance.
Yeah.
2006, now presenting the children's. Something is wrong when your own parents kick you. Something is wrong when your parents will use your gift to their own advantage. In case you're looking at me wayward, I'm talking to those of you who have the phone in your child's name. In case you don't know who I'm talking about, I'm talking to those of you who have your child answer the phone when the bill collector calls. In case you don't know who I'm talking about, I'm talking to those of you who cuss out the teacher but don't show up for PTA. You're pimping your child's gift, and you have your child dancing in front of drunk men. She's dancing, and I wish I could get a video of what kind of dance she was doing. But whatever dance it was, it entreated the king. And when it entreated the king, it arrested his attention. And he is so taken by her dance that the king says something that absolutely mesmerizes my attention. The king says, hear this, based off of how you dance, whatever you want, you can have. I better pause because I think I lost somebody here today. Can you imagine that God is saying in this sanctuary that based off of how you dance, whatever it is you want, you can have. See, some of you are too uptight in church. You're too restricted. You are too held back. You are too held hostage by what it is that other people are going to say and think and feel. But when you understand that my dance will do something for the king, that my dance is so captivating that when the king sees my dance, he'll give me whatever it is that I want. See, this makes no sense to those of you who are not praisers. But those of you who understand, I will enter to his gates with thanksgiving, and I'll enter to his courts with praise, and I'll bless his holy name. See, some of you checked out because you didn't know what was happening. You thought it was for us. But there were those of us who had enough sense to understand that I'm not at the altar to be in the camera. I'm not crying like that to be seen. I'm not doing any of this so that folk might be in my business, but I'm dancing for the king. I wish I had worship in church in here. That there's somebody in here who knows that I wish it had enough Friday nights and Saturday nights in a club for no reason, sweating until my clothes stuck to my body, dealing with folk with bad breath, hanging on folk, step on my shoes, tired when I finally got back home. But don't you know when you dance in the presence of the king, there is no way you can go back home the same way you got here. But if there's somebody who knows that the king is watching, and if this is my last opportunity, let me do my dance so that God will know for you. I want to see you dance, because based off of your dance, you can get what it is that you want. And then let me deal with it deductively. In other words, if you don't need nothing from the king, don't dance. I think I lost you. If all of your bills are paid, please don't dance. If you don't need a new job, don't dance. If your supervisor ain't on your nerves, don't dance. If your children don't need a breakthrough, don't dance. If you don't have no sickness or issues in your body, don't dance. But if you need the king to do something for you, and you want him to do it for you tonight, and if you got to turn over chains and knock down pews and run and get in the face of God, God said, if you need something from me, you can't be afraid to dance in front of me. Be seated, please. Be seated. Look at the person beside you and tell them, I can tell you don't need anything. I can tell you're not in a desperate situation. I can tell your back is not up against the wall. But if you need what I need, if you've been crying the way I've been crying, if you've been under attack the way I've been under attack, tonight your mouth, the dance floor is open.
out the window and says, how undignified is that? And he shouts back up to the window, you ain't seen nothing yet. I'm dancing not for God, I'm dancing not for race. I'm dancing, I says, I ain't bringing sexy back, I'm bringing the glory back. God, I need somebody here who wants the glory back in your life. Says, what do you want? Whatever you want, you can have it tonight. And I just missed you. Let me back that thing up. Give it to you again. Whatever you want, you can get it tonight. If you're not too shy to dance in front of the king. See, if you caught up on folk rolling their eyes and sucking their teeth, you might have to wait another 6 months. But if you need so she had to consult with her mother. If she had known for herself what she wanted, she would have never had to ask anybody else. I'm talking to those of you. You don't need nobody to give you no recommendation about what you're giving God the glory for. But you got three things on your mind right now.
Yeah! promise, he delivered me. He set me free. He brought me out. I'm gonna dance in his face. I'm gonna glorify him in his face. I've got to get the attention of God. I've got to get his attention. I'm gonna raise my hands. If I couldn't say a word, if I couldn't do anything else, I'd just raise my hands. If you can't do nothing else, just raise your hand. Just raise your hand. Ah, yeah. I got a reason to give God praise. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, yes. He's worthy. He's worthy of the praise. He's worthy of the honor. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I'm going to dance in his face. For the Bible says that I will bless the Lord at all times, and his praises shall continually be in my mouth. My soul shall be the most of the Lord. The humble shall hear the Lord and be glad. You want to know what that third verse says? It says, oh, magnify the Lord with me. I tell you what, that's an invitation. I'm giving you an invitation, an open invitation. If you want to praise God with me, you have an invitation. If you want to lift up the name of Jesus, that's your invitation. What he said? He said the floor is open. Yes, sir. I'm gonna praise him every chance I get. Cause he's worthy. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. And when the music stops, you still have a voice. Open up your mouth and jump on, yes. I said when the music stops. Yes, sir, yes, sir. We have a reason to give God the praise. Hallelujah. We're going to turn it back over to our mistress of ceremony, amen, Sister Zoe Scout. Can we say amen for her?
mindset. It's a kingdom mindset. Let me hear ya. Where my Eden citizens at? Where my Eden citizens at? Where you at? Let me see you do your hands like this. Here we go.
When God made man, he made a spirit. It was his plan that we live blessed. The tempter came, we were distracted. The tempter came, and we fell. We were deemed to live a life that's beautiful, a life that's warm, a life that's rich and plentiful. It is my goal to remind you of this principle.
Real quick, they were supposed to praise dance yesterday at the talent show, but because time got away from us, I spoke with the youth president to see if they could slide in on this youth Sunday. All right, so just wanted to clarify that. We wanted to give all the children an opportunity, but time got away from us.
Amen.
So we're going to give them an opportunity this morning. All right,
amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen. But you created me to worship
Yes.
So I'ma leave it all right here. Help me serve
you. You did not create me to worship.
Ephraim. deserve.
I'm just looking around. I'm seeing a sunshine band on the organ. Mother walk down, MC'ing. Amen. Reaching. All come from Sunshine Band. Unbelievable. Amen. Now, a whole other group in training. So don't y'all worry, the church is going to be all right. Where's, what's her name? She's in college. Jones. Where's she at? She here? Divine, that she is. Sunshine Bounder. Stand up, Black folks, see you. This girl got a full ride. God is good. I'm purposing my heart not to talk a lot today. Amen. I want us to hear this preacher. Amen. Minister Campbell, I was looking at you as you were sitting over there, and I was thinking about how our children performed in Amarillo, and they just lit up the house down in Amarillo this past week. And Sunshine Band folks used to be grown now. Amen. And I'm just ecstatically happy. Thank you for coming today. Amen. Our preacher's getting ready to come. Amen. Can y'all imagine? Y'all missing it. Y'all don't get what I'm getting.
Come on, Pastor.
And these were little kids when I was
pastor.
Them, I was their grandmother's pastor. Amazing, Brother Taggart. And I'm just so ecstatically happy God has allowed me to stay here to see you all. And the half has not been told.
Hallelujah.
Don't fool yourself. God didn't send us over here to fail.
Yes, sir.
He gave us this name. He put us in this building. He's in charge.
Yes, sir.
And when this preacher gets through preaching, you're going to understand he's with the preachers too. Would you rest on your feet? Please, as Minister Sales is coming. I look over there on my right and I see Missionary Harris. I see a daughter. I see a granddaughter. Amen. I see Mother Sales. You've been with us for 30. It's amazing, Sister. All those.
Yes.
You all don't know how happy I really am. And how blessed I really feel. Amen. You really don't know. I wanted to let you all know. Chantel is in California with Melvin from first break she's had in about 20 years. And hopefully she'll be back home next week. But thank God for Stephen. He and his brothers went with me. We went and built a body shop. We built the Williams body shop when they were little boys. Amen. They went with me as my crew, as my work crew. Amen. I have so much history. I remember Minister Ford, she was 18 years old when she came to Progressive. Brother, amen, all the years. We were struggling then, though. But you saved now. Brother saved. God's good. Good God. Give this young man your full attention as he comes in his own way. Come on, give God a hand for him. Now do it again, like you can give God a hand for him. Before I even start talking, Lord, I give you the praise, the honor, and glory, for you are the author and finisher of our faith. I thank you, God, for you are God and God alone.
Yes.
No one else can help us but you, for our help comes only from you. It can't come from man, it's not equipped enough. It can't come from money, it's not valuable enough. It can't come from ourselves because we failed so many times, God. But our help only comes from you. For that, we give you the praise, the honor, and the glory, for you are justly due, God.
Yes.
And I'm going to piggyback off of the praise dance. God, if no one else would dance for you, God, I will.
Yeah.
If no one else would praise your name, I will.
Yeah.
Even when I'm waiting, God, I still praise your name, God.
Yeah.
Because you alone are worthy.
Yes, yes.
Lord God, and touch these your people.
Yes, yes.
Give them eyes to see, ears to hear, a mind to understand, a heart to receive, God. Let them not see me, let them see you. Let them not praise me, let them praise you. Let them not worship me, let them worship you, God. This is your word, this is your sermon, and these are your people. In Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. You may be seated. Remember when the pastor was talking about people who grew up in the church? I grew up and lived in this church. Literally. And as Pastor already knows, this church and him, this is all I knew. And while growing up in this church, I learned one simple fact. That even though I did not want to acknowledge it, God is all I know.
Yeah,
man. All right. I tried other stuff. I tried robbery. I did that. I tried gangbanging. I did that. I tried breaking up people's homes. I did that. I tried selling drugs. I did that. I tried hitting people up. I did that. I tried selling cocaine. I tried that. I did all this stuff, but in the back of my mind,
Jesus.
All I heard was, I am all you know.
Yeah.
In the midst of all the things that I was going through, God literally told me this while I was selling on the corner. God said to me, the only reason why you're alive is because your mama's praying for you at home. And God told me right then and there, I am your savior and your deliverer. When will you get it? Because this, no, let's try this again. This is all I know. I can't live without God. I'm not strong enough to do it. I can't breathe without him. I can't think without him. I can't live without God. I can't do anything. It's not just a term of phrase. This isn't just some tradition that I grew up to do. I used to go to church every single day.
Every day.
Every day. Now, I used to get annoyed. Like, why am I going to church? This is stupid.
Yeah.
Well, I'm going to church with people I'm going to see on the corner later on. This is dumb. Now, not only that, why am I saying hi to people when they're sitting here sitting when someone else is passing them?
Listen!
I couldn't understand it at first. I thought church was supposed to be for perfect people until God says, let's turn the mirror around real quick.
All right.
Yeah.
But now I know God is all I need. And God is all I require. I don't care who leaves me. Yeah. At this point in my life, I don't care who leaves. Yeah. I don't care who's my friend and who's not.
All right.
Come on.
Don't matter.
I don't care who's my brother and who's not. It does not matter. Because I tell God, if I can have anything in this world, I just want you.
All right.
And I remember I prayed on the floor so hard. God says, God, don't take your presence from me.
Yeah.
I'm trying to get to the word, but I have to feel this. I have to say this. I have to tell God, and I pleaded with him, don't take your presence from me. Because this world is horrible.
Yes.
People are backstabbing each other every single day, and they laugh at your face, at your pain. God, I need you.
Jesus.
You must not feel it the way I do. You must not feel it the way you haven't been broken down before. To a point to where even your family can't help you. When the only thing that helped you out was the own tears that came from your eyes, and you tell God, I need you.
Come on.
To help me.
Right.
I need God.
Come on, sir.
Lord have mercy.
Yes, Lord.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, sir.
And that's when I became bold. Because if you know Lord, if you know the Lord, if you trust and believe in him, you become bold in him.
Yes, sir.
That I don't care what they do to me. My praise will still be in my mouth. I don't care what happens to my body. And I don't care if I'm in the hospital and they got a respirator on me.
Yeah.
While I'm unconscious, I'm still praising your name. I don't care if I'm in a coma. I will praise your name in my mind. I don't care if they take my hands from me. I still got a feet to use. I still got a praise in my belly that I will always use. Because God, you are awesome. You're magnificent. You're passionate. You're ever loving. And you care. So why wouldn't I praise you? That's not my word. Why wouldn't I praise you? Why won't I lift your name up? So if I have to stand in an empty building full of people, and I be the only one praising your name, God, you will see my hand raise up. God, I'm in the midst of a broken people. Broken and contrite, but God, know this now. I make my testament unto you. If no one else would do it, I will. I'll dance like David said. Just tell me when to do it. I'm standing right here at the start line. Tell me when to praise you. Matter of fact, you don't need to tell me. I don't need no one else to tell me when to praise the name of God. I said this before, I'm not here to pump and prime you.
Come on, sir.
My mom's are here to tell you that God is justly due for praise.
Yes, sir.
At every single moment, time, and seconds that you go through. Even the times when you ignore them. I'm not going to go there.
All right. Man.
Rest on your feet if you don't mind. We're going to go to Hebrews. I'm going to go to Hebrews 10, 35 and 36. And I got a secondary scripture for you, but let's go to the first one first. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 35 and 36. When you have it, say amen.
Amen.
If you don't, say wait a minute. Yep. Hebrews 10, 35 and 36. Hebrews 35, cast not away therefore your confidence, which hath great recompense of reward.
Yes, sir.
For ye have need of patience, that after ye have done the will of God, ye might receive the promise. I'm going to add one more in there. For yet a little while, and he that shall come will come, and will not tarry. Secondary scripture is going to the book of John. John 14, 12 through 17. I'll wait. The book of John, chapter 14, verse 12 to 17. Verse 12, verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do, shall he do also. And greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. And whatsoever ye shall ask in my name, that I will do. You should underline that. That the Father may be glorified in the Son. If ye shall ask anything in my name, I will do it. Y'all missed that during the praise.
Come on with it.
If ye love me, keep my commandments. And I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter. That he may abide with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him, but ye know him, for he dwelleth with you and shall be in you. Now I'm going to jump down to 26. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I have said unto you. You may be seated.
Amen.
The theme title of this one, I got two of them this time, is called The Contagion.
the contagion. Secondary topic is the necessity of faith. And if y'all don't know what I mean by now, you're going to get it later. The necessity of faith. Faithlessness is a disease that is spreading around at an alarming rate. It has taken the lives of millions of people and counting. It is a terror that goes around while noticeable but uncontested. It causes more damage than the bombs of Nagasaki and Hiroshima combined. Deadlier than any tasteless, fragrantless disease, and has broken more homes than any disaster. Yeah. And has cost a man his life without leaving a trace. The signs of the infection are clear for all to see, but just as fast as it shows up, it leaves just the same. This disease is airborne. It gets passed around by close contact and by word of mouth. Body suits can't shield you. Medicines can't make you immune. And a bunker can't hide you. While this disease is a terror of our lifetime, it is also one of the oldest. And thanks to today's technology, it's also the most profitable. You can see it on TV. You can watch it in movies, and you can see it on children's television. You can find its victims everywhere, and for some, it's in their very homes. The way it attacks is subtle. It doesn't affect you when you're at your strongest. The attack comes when you're at your weakest. And it starts in the brain, making the victim delusional, making it hard for the person to tell the difference between the truth and the lie. Slowly lowering your defenses and causing memory lapse and hallucinations. Okay. It makes you believe God is not with you, but he was there all the time. Oh, then it moves to the main target, which is the heart. Here it incubates and metastasizes, causing the heart to grow weak and defenseless. One sign of this attack is the very warmth of the victim's blood seems stolen away. And the body is cold on the inside, but on the outside, no one is the wiser. And it goes unnoticeable. But while this disease is very debilitating and deadly, it is also extremely easy to cure.
All right.
While some will sigh the sigh of relief and say, oh, it's just faithlessness, that's okay. And they just go ahead and just brush this little thing off. There are some of us who knows just how dangerous it can be. And how close, and they can testify to you just how close they came to losing their faith in God.
All right, come on, sir.
And that goes for every single person in the sound of my voice.
Come on now.
Come on, sir.
While some may say, my faith is strong, I don't have to worry about this. You weren't part of the ones who stood in prayer day after day.
Yes, sir.
For a situation to turn around, for a loved one to pull through, but the complete opposite happens.
All right.
As if to say it wasn't enough. Being faithless is a tragic thing. Even the most faithful has faced this disease, and if left untreated, it can steal your very covering over your soul. It makes a person feel unwanted, overlooked, and they will begin to think that they are worthless. When in truth, it's the exact opposite. Being faithless steals away the gift of confidence you once had in this life. And it makes us forget that while we are spiritual beings having an earthly experience, this life and life circumstances will seek to steal the gift that was given to you and to put you in the one place you do not want to be.
Well,
and that place is at odds with God.
All right, sir.
As said in Hebrews 10:31, it is a fearful thing.
Yeah.
To fall into the hands of the living God.
Okay.
And faith, without faith, it is impossible to please God.
Yes, sir.
And I'm going to pause right there.
Okay, sir.
You don't know how bad faithlessness can be.
Uh-huh.
Faithlessness is a type of thing that once you lose faith in God, you lose faith in everything.
Oh, watch out, sir.
Matter of fact, you lose faith in people. And you will become a cold thing that does not care about no one else's feelings nor your own. Faithlessness is disastrous because not only that, you don't even care for your own life.
Come on now.
And you will purposely put yourself in danger because you think to yourself, I do not care what happens to me. I have been in a place where I told God to his face, I do not trust you anymore. And I have decided to use my anger as a shield. I was like, Satan has been better to me than you have.
Whoa.
I'll be transparent here.
Come on.
I've told him to his face that I'd rather use him because he gave me what I wanted was revenge. And it felt warm as a blanket. And I told God, I would not trust you anymore. And so God said, let's find out. Don't push God now. Don't push him. Because then you will find out his patience will be very short with you. And God will put you, he will put you in your place quickly. So God says, since you think you can't live without me, let's see how far you go. And then when I said it just now, I said the very warmth of your blood seems still on the way, and that's how I felt. You cannot walk across me. Because only thing that came to my mind was how in which way can I kill you?
All right.
Yeah.
Jesus.
And off and if you wanted to get buck with me. Get froggy if you want to. I had something on my hip that was ready for you. And if you couldn't catch me in the streets, you will find me in your house.
Yeah.
I'll get you when I get you. And the fear of God was not in me. Until one day.
Yeah.
To one day. One day as I was getting ready to go to bed because I just got done doing some dirty stuff. God said, now I'm going to show you where you're going. And he showed me a very hot gate. I can't describe it to you, but I'm going to try my best to. He said, I'm going to show you this gate that's waiting to open up for you. Twisted and broken, that's what this gate was. Locked up with chains that I couldn't even unlock. But the closer I got to it, the more it started to shake. The gate was so hot that the bars itself will melt your skin off. But it doesn't compare to the heat that came behind it.
Okay. All right, sir.
And God says, I'm going to give you a taste of what is waiting for you without me. And he opened the gate just a little bit. And I got in just a little bit. And I told my wife this. I was like, I have a fear of something, being stuck in a place that I can't get out of, and I'm stuck in my mind. I can't free myself in. And if I try to kill myself or whatever, God will bring me back in life. And I'm still in that same spot. And this place took your worst fears. And it will use it against you and amplify it. And it terrified me. And I asked God, what is this place?
Yeah.
And he says, this is where the guy that you decided to follow is at. This is where I am not going to be. Because when you go down in this place, I will not be with you.
Yes, sir.
And I told God then, I can't take this heat. Because this heat is too much for me. I can't take the turmoil and the screams that I'm hearing. It wakes me up at night. I can't sleep. And all because I decided to let the enemy steal my faith. Now I'm going back to the word. Faithlessness will make you forget just how important it is to have faith.
Yeah.
That faith came with a price that wasn't a price that you had to pay. Pause right there. Your faith came freely because God paid the price for you. Your worship is free because God paid the price for you. Your worship is free because God paid the price for you. Would you complain if you go to a Louis Vuitton store and say, here's a free purse, and you ask, why am I getting a free purse? Because someone paid the price for you. Would you complain about that? Okay, let's go to basketball. Let's go to football fans. Let's say you go to a football game and it's the box seats. And someone says you can have these tickets for free because someone paid the price for you. Would you deny the prize? If you go to our car lot and you have the chance to get yourself a 2023 Range Rover. With the key. And the lease and the title. And they say to you, you can make this in any color you want. You can customize this any type of way you want. He said, Lord, that's mine right there. I'm going to claim it. He's like, don't even worry about claiming it. It's yours. Because someone paid the price for you. Would you complain about that?
No, I would not.
But yet, you know, I just mentioned materialistic things. I just got done mentioning materialistic things, but when your praise is called to question. When the praise and worship is called to question. That your praise is going to be the one thing that can get you out. Because someone paid the price for you. Will you complain about that?
All right, sir.
Faith, I'm going to say this again. Faithlessness will make you forget just how important it is to have faith. That faith came with a price, that it wasn't a price that you had to pay. And I know life can get hard or terrible or even impossible. And some people will hang their strength on their of their faith on other people.
Yes, they will.
Have you ever put your faith in somebody else?
Yeah.
You put your faith in someone else thinking, you're going to have my back.
Got my back.
You got my back.
I mean, listen.
Now, you are the person that I know. If anybody else is not going to be in my corner, you are going to be in my corner. And I mean that goes down to if I'm in a fight,
you in the fight.
You in the fight.
Oh yeah.
Blood in, blood out.
Like my mom used to tell me, if you fight one of us,
all of us.
There's no way I'm letting my siblings fight by themselves.
That's right,
sir.
If you put your faith in these people. You put your faith in these people. And you hang your faith on these other people, only to be let down when you act like the humans that they are.
Yes.
But I asked you a question in Romans 3:3-4, what if some did not believe? Shall their unbelief make the faith of God without effect? And let me put this in layman terms. Just because they were unfaithful does not mean that God is faithless.
Come on, sir.
Just because they didn't have your back doesn't mean that God does not have your back. Just because they're the ones who are the main ones stabbing you in the back does not mean that God is not faithful.
Come on, sir.
Don't forget, it is your faith that keeps you rooted in this life. Ooh, I'm almost done. Don't forget, it is your faith that keeps you rooted in this life. It is your faith that will help you endure. It is your faith that will protect you against attacks. It is your faith that will allow you to do what others would seem impossible. Yeah. It is your faith that pleases God. It is your faith that moves God. It is your faith that activates the promises of God. It is your faith that moves mountains. It is your faith that caused the enemy to tremble. It is your faith that caused your household to be saved. It is your faith that caused the very impossible seem possible. It is your faith that causes God to stand up from the throne and come into your situation. It is your faith that turns your midnight into the end. It is your faith that calls down the power of God. It is your faith that causes the promises of God into fruition. And the faith that I have now is the faith that I need for later. My faith gives me the opportunity to hope. It is the evidence of a victory not yet seen. My faith gives me God's approval. Even when I become a laughing stock, my faith lets me know I'm still God's child. My faith is now faith. I have the faith of now faith. I'll say that again. I have the faith of now faith. I don't need to wait until the battle is over for my victory. I can receive it now. Because of my now faith. Someone said now faith. I can use the authority of God that has given it to me. I don't have to wait until the test results come back. I can claim my healing now. I don't
to wait for the prognosis to come to me. I will claim my victory now. I don't have to wait no more for my deliverance to come. I can claim it now. I can claim it in deliverance. I can claim it in victory. I can claim it even as I'm sitting. I can claim it now. I don't have to wait to praise God for a blessing that is to come. I will praise God in the waiting room if I have to. Even if I have to wait, my faith shall and will sustain me. For God has sent another comforter. For when this world and people tell me lies, my comforter is called the Spirit of Truth. When I forget the goodness of God, the Holy Ghost, that's who I'm going to. The Holy Ghost will bring all things to my remembrance. John 14 and 26. The Holy Ghost remind me the things that were promised to me. The things that were set apart just for me. It is the Holy Ghost that keeps me rooted and grounded in God. It is the Holy Ghost that brings power to my prayer. It is the Holy Ghost that brings power to my worship. It is the Holy Ghost that brings power to my walk. It is the Holy Ghost that brings power when I talk. It is the Holy Ghost when I get the power when I preach. And it doesn't matter how good of a showman talker or wordsmith or how good of an articulate your sermon. Without the Holy Ghost, you're just speaking nice. I won't say that again. It does not matter how good you are at preaching a sermon and how you articulate your words. But without the Holy Ghost, you just speak very nice to me. That also means it doesn't matter how good you sing, how good you praise, how good you dance, how good you play. But without the Holy Ghost, only thing you're doing is entertaining me. It is the Holy Ghost that interprets the will of God to me. But when I need to know the will of God, the Holy Ghost will tell me thus. It is the Holy Ghost that keeps me bound to the Word of God. Even when I try to run from it, I'm bound to it. When I try to ignore it, it's all I hear. When I try not to speak about it, it's like fire shut up in my bones. I can't live without it. I can't sleep without it. I can't breathe without it. I can't eat without it. I can't walk without it. I can't talk without it. I can't live without it. God, I need it. I can't do nothing without it. Because the Holy Ghost. And I came to realize that my faith gives me access to the Holy Ghost. And through the Holy Ghost, I get the access to the power that is in the Word of God. While there are those who are afflicted with faithlessness, my God, the great physician, has given us the Word as a remedy. The Word that changes things. The Word that delivers. The Word that picks me up. The Word that heals me. The Word that strengthens me. The Word that benefits me. The Word that guides me. The Word that never lies to me. The Word that heals me. The Word that reveals to me the promises of heaven. The Word that is my weapon. The Word that is my shield. The Word that is my buckler. The Word that is my guide. The Word that is my cornerstone. The Word. The Word that heals the sick. The Word that opens up blinded eyes. The Word that heals the broken heart. The Word that set free. The Word that delivers. The Word of promise. The Word that separates the real from the fake. The Word that reminds me of the goodness of God. The Word that reminds me my faith is a substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. The Word that reminds me to hold on to my faith. The Word that reminds me you don't need your faith out the way. The Word that reminds me, hold on to your faith. For answers in this life will seek to take it from you. Hold on to your faith. The enemy wants to take your life. Hold on to your faith. The enemy wants to take your joy. Hold on to your faith. The enemy wants to take your power. Hold on to your faith. your body. Hold on to your faith. When the enemy attacks your marriage, hold on to your faith. When the enemy attacks your child, hold on to your faith. When the enemy attacks your dog, hold on to your faith. When the enemy attacks your church, hold on to your faith. When the enemy attacks your faith, hold on to your faith. Tell your neighbor, hold on, hold on, hold on. You need to hold on. You need to hold on.
Whew,
that felt good.
Everybody, I said that again.
The word that reminds me, hold on to your faith. So you're going to need it after a while. Hold on to your faith. For issues of this life will seek to take it from you. Don't lose your covering. Your answers are coming in due time. Hold on to it. Don't let they take it from you. It's so hard to receive it, so hard to keep it. Don't let nothing in this world separate you from the love of God. Declare your faith whole. Declare your faith in God. I stand on it. I fight for it. I plead for it. I believe on it. I suffer for it. I stand for it. I stand in it. I will always stand on the God. Was going to allow me to see the face of God. And I will see him. And I shall see him. And I shall see him for myself. For myself. For my faith. It's the very access to see the one who took the nails for me. My faith. Gives me access to the one who took the spear from me. My faith is the very one who allowed me to see the one that healed me when I was sick, bounded up my broken heart. I would be able to see the one that turned my whole house upside down and gave me victory. I would be able to see the one who came to my deathbed and said, "You're not going to die here today." I would be able to see the one. When man takes your virtue from you, God says you're still worth more than rubies. I will be able to see the one who, when people tell you are worthless, and you don't mean anything, that your children will never be anything, God says I have made you more than a conqueror. I will be able to see the one. Does anybody know who I'm talking about? Knows what I'm talking about. What's his name? Try that again. What's his name?
Jesus.
Try it again. What's his name?
Jesus.
When you were in help, who came to help you?
Jesus.
When you were sick, who healed you?
Jesus.
When you were lost, who found you?
Jesus.
When you couldn't walk, who picked you up?
Jesus.
When you were weak, who gave you strength?
Jesus.
We had no power, who gave you power?
Jesus.
We had no worship, who gave you a worship? We had no praise, who gave you a praise? We had no dance, who gave you a dance? We can have no help, who gave you your help? Now I'm gonna pick you back off of Malachi. I want to be in a spot. But God says, all you have to do is just ask me.
Yeah.
And I will give it to you.
Yeah.
And all I'm thinking takes is a dance. You know how easy that is?
Yeah.
All it takes is a dance. So I'm going to say it for you as well. The dance floor is open. All you need is a dance to get your breakthrough. All you need is your dance to cause the enemy to flee from. All you need is your dance. What's holding you down? What's keeping your feet from dancing? What's keeping your mouth shut? It is my faith that keeps me from falling. And it also prevents me from this. My faith is what causes God's power to move. My faith is the main reason I'm still here. My faith is the main reason why I'm still living. My faith is the main reason.
with all this talking and trying to shake you up. Do not forget this. Your faith is your key to deliverance. Your faith is the very thing that can turn everything around.
Yeah.
When no one else and nothing else will help.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Love.
Love.
Lifted.
Yeah.
Me.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Can I be I'm almost done. Can I be transparent just for a little bit, Pastor? Sir, second service? Okay. I'm gonna say this and I'm done. I've been a part of this church for a long time. I've seen turmoil every single day in people's eyes.
All right.
Lack of faith runs rampant in the church of God.
Yeah.
Because we ask God for something, we expect it to happen immediately, but we forget about the process.
Yes.
We forget about the process that it takes to get there.
Yeah.
It was said on last Sunday, it took you years to get into it.
Right.
It's going to take some time to get you out of it.
Yeah.
But there are some things that you can pray to God to answer it for you now.
That's
and
it.
He will also give it to you now.
That's it.
Come on, sir.
You don't have to be you don't have to be unhappy forever.
That's it.
All right.
Glory.
And you don't have to be in defeat forever. Your victory can come today.
Yes, sir.
If your faith holds out.
Yeah.
Oh.
That's the purpose of this. Hold on to your faith.
Yes.
Because the way the world is going now, you're going to need it.
Yes.
I just read now that Christianity, the faith in God has been falling dramatically.
Yes.
And they're predicting now that in like a few more short years, Christianity will be the minority in the world. Because less and less people are holding on to their faith. Because they don't see the reason to have it. Okay, they don't think God relates to today's times. Hold on to it. Because when this world turns its back on you, you're going to need your faith to hold you strong. And your faith is the main reason why your children will be saved. I'm talking to you. Your faith will be the very key to turn your children around. And you will see the power of God move within them. So instead of saying, I'm worthless and I'm not going to make it and I'm not a good mom.
Yeah.
I'm not a good parent. I failed my children. Say, God, I give it to you.
Yeah.
I put my faith in you. God, you take them.
Yeah.
That goes for any mother in you who's still praying about their children.
Yeah.
Even when they're grown.
Right.
God says, give them to me.
Yeah.
I'm the one who gave them to you. Give them back to me. And watch what I do. Because of your faith, I will turn them around. And because of your faith, I will turn you around. Watch God move.
I'm looking around at everybody in the room. Seem to be members of this group already.
Amen.
If there's one here that's not a member, you're looking at this church being the place you need to be. Doors are open. Did not he preach?
Amen.
Thank you. I don't know. I feel some kind of way today. I feel that there's a blessing in the room.
Yes, God.
Why don't you just reach up and get it?
Okay.
You already got the word. Did you get it? You got it in the children singing. You got it in prayer. You already got the word. Reach up and get it. Tell the Lord thank you. Tell the Lord thank you. Come on, tell the Lord thank you. I see one with a cane bringing one up that don't have a cane that needs a cane. How about spiritual? Say amen, somebody. Where's my water? Listen, don't ever block someone from coming for prayer. Say amen, somebody. See, your faith, that's what they've been talking about. Look at yourself, test yourself, and say, I'm going to be all right. Because say, Sam, I'm going to be all right. Now say, I am all right. Sam! Tell yourself, I'm more. Tell me why you gotta keep begging and you're a child of God. I'll tell you why. You keep opening the door. How long you gonna keep opening the door front to come and attack you? Shut the door! You want him out of your life? Shut him out! Taking your money, taking your honey, taking your mind. Give me a break. Shut the door. Shut the door, I said. Tell them to get on down the road. No more. I'm through with it. I'm not gonna be sick no more either. I'm not gonna be depressed. I decided I'm not gonna be depressed anymore. I'm decided I ain't nobody's doormat no more. I'm decided I know who I am. Decided, not a weakling. I don't need nobody pity party. I ain't nobody's punching bag. I'm a child of God. Command you to take control of what you have.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Yeah, God.
Yes, Lord.
Go ahead, son.
You got a gun? Shoot it.
Yes, sir.
You got a prayer pistol? Shoot it. Walking around with it in your pocket, won't pull it out, won't shoot it, won't take advantage of it. What can I do for you? You got the tools. Use them. Father, in the name of Jesus, touch right now. Give it a power. Overcome everything. From the inside out, from the top down, from the bottom up. In the name of Jesus. Say, I'm free now. I may be crying. Talk to me. I may be crying. But I'm free now. I may be hurting.
Jesus.
I declare victory for you, physically, mentally, and financially, in the name of Jesus. Give God a praise and go up and be blessed. Tell the Lord, thank you. If I would allow the enemy to take me over, I'd be laying down on the floor. Stand up for yourself. Stand up in the Lord. To hell with the devil. That's where he belongs. Well, I'm sick. Okay, you're in a body. Your body, you done ate all kind of stuff. They done all kind of stuff to you ever since you was born. Yes, your body gonna get sick. But I know the healer.
Yeah.
I gotta teach people a new, I got to teach you more than what I'm just telling you to reach and get. I'm telling you, if you want to get well, start doing things that well people do. You don't want to be mentally wiped out. Quit letting folk wipe you out. You a man and you unhappy? Woman cheating on you, get rid of her. Man won't live right, won't pay your bills, get rid of that dog. Send him on down the road. He ain't doing you no good, no way. Come that pray. Yeah, you ain't gonna never get fixed. Because every time you get up, he gonna tear you down. You done worked all the week, all the month. You done got your little check and got your food stamps. And here this joker come in and sell your stamps. What you need with him? Let him sleep while you at work. What you need with him? She know y'all going through. She spent every penny before you can get paid. But your check is already gone. What you need? Somebody said money answers all things. But if you ain't got none, you ain't got the answer. Say yes. Say yes. Say yes. Stand up straight. Do like Sister Hazel did. Go ahead and tell them folks, y'all ain't fix my car. I ain't happy with y'all. Open your mouth. They gave her part of her money back. You keep shut up. Look at yourself and say, I look at myself and I'm 87 years old. I looked in the mirror. I put my shirt back on because I didn't like what I saw. I don't see no six pack. I don't see no four pack. But I used to have an eight pack. Don't play with yourself like that. Tell yourself the truth. So I can make it by myself. They gonna need me before I need them. Y'all ain't talking to me. Thank you so long with water. Oh, thank you. Oh, shut up. Give God some praise. Tell him I'm strong. I'm saved. I'm able. I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my man. I know the healer. I know the way maker. I know the burden bearer. I know the deliverer. I know the keeper. I know it for myself. Missionary Ball's daughter's in the hospital. We getting ready to receive our offering, y'all. Somebody tell the Lord, thank you. Look at somebody, say, I'm already a conqueror. I'm already an overcomer. I'm already powerful.
All right, grateful. It's done. Tell Lord, I'll thank you. My daughter's running amok, and she won't change. Girl, if you don't change, you're going to hell. I've done all I can for you. I done fed you, I done clothed you, I done raised you. I done gave you a house, I done sent you to school. I done done all that, and you still cussing me out? Get out of my house. Oh boy, he now he's strong. He can get up, he can press 200 pounds and won't pick up a one sweep the floor. Get out! You nasty devil, I didn't raise you like that. I see your hand. I'm talking to somebody. Got these people wearing us out. Get out! She had really us out there. I'ma quit bailing you out. I ain't gonna pay your bond no more. I ain't gonna pay your fine no more. I ain't gonna give you no more money for gas for your car. I ain't paying your light bill no more. I ain't gonna help you no more on your rent. I'm preaching. They come from no. You coming right? I'm just commenting.
She's scared. She coming for
justice. I understand. She's coming at the right time. See, I know when the Lord began to deal with me. I know exactly what the Lord helped me doing. I know what I'm doing, but I know what the Lord got me doing. He got me talking to somebody, and death is riding.
Amen.
I said death.
Yeah.
It's riding.
Yeah.
Raise your hand. You got that turkey dress on. I don't want to miss that. This clear water. You're crying out. Just keep crying. Don't give up.
Don't give up.
Yes.
Don't give up.
Give up.
See, you got faith. Don't give up.
Yes.
That's it. That's what you do. Crown your head to the soup of your feet. And he got a good mediator for him. He got a good prayer warrior for him. The best you can do is what you're doing now. Keep him up before the master. He's the one know where he's at the midnight hour. Tell the Lord thank you. Look to my, I know him. My prayers work. On you, Laura. I know my prayers work. I know my prayers work. I ain't gonna let nobody take my joy. I know my prayers work. I know they work. But there were some places Jesus went, and he couldn't work no miracles. The lack of faith he preached about. You all are not those people. I've been knowing y'all, most of you, all your life. I watched y'all come from death's door, out of hell's furnace, out of a pit of whatever, out of drowning waters, out of acid pits. I don't watch y'all come out of all kind of trouble, everything you can think of, and you still standing? Don't tell me you're not overcomers.
Yeah.
I don't want you raise your kid by yourself.
buy your own cars, pay your own rent, pay your mama's bills. I done watch y'all do everything good. Don't tell me you're not an overcomer.
Yeah.
Claim your power.
Right.
Claim it.
Claim it.
It's mine. Bring the table. How long y'all been married now? 30 years at least. And you used to be so drunk you didn't know your way home.
Back in the church.
Stand to the church. Don't tell me you're not ready. Don't tell me that. I don't want to hear that from New Vision.
Yeah.
I want New Vision to pick up their sword.
Yeah.
Start cutting some of these devils' hands off.
Yeah.
Don't cut the head off yet.
Man.
Cut the hand off so they can't get in your pocket no more.
Yeah.
Y'all all out. We got another. And when they reach after that zipper, hit them on the hand with a sledgehammer.
Yeah.
So don't unzip your pants in here.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Go ahead and take
that. The devil is alive.
Yeah.
Not going to let him contaminate God's people. Destroy. He come to steal, kill, and destroy. My job is to kill him. And if I can't kill him, bring him under subjection for a minute. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. He'll come back, but if you resist him, he'll flee from you. Don't let him put his hands on. Ladies, you all so precious. Keep these scumbags away from you. Praise God. This baby got faith. In the name of Jesus, touch your body. Tell the Lord, thank you. Let me tell y'all something. When I was about her size, my belly was protruded. My mom and I had been so hungry, we'd ate so much pork, fresh pork, until I had tapeworms. Y'all know tracheotomy is something that comes from, and they pull them long worms out of me. And my stomach was messed up until I got grown. Feed your kids right. Couldn't let them eat anything they want. Oh God, help this old man. Lord, I'm your servant. I heard him tell me, he said, tell these people. I didn't want to do no prayer. He said, but when they come up, tell them what I tell you to tell them. Claim your power. Tithers are coming. If you're a tither, bring your tithers. Thank you. Tell the Lord, thank you.